Joining us in Weehawken, New Jersey is Nancy Giles. She hosts the Giles Files, or the Giles File.
It's Files, plural.
The Giles Files, yes. On iTunes. Go download it right now. You can see her on MSNBC. You can see her on CBS Sunday Morning. Her new show, I believe it's a one-woman show?
No, this is a variety show that I host that's called The Mosquito. That's once a month on the Lower East Side in New York City.
DixonPlace.org. Go to DixonPlace.org and buy tickets to see Mosquito, the Nancy Giles variety show. It's in the East Village. What is the date?
The next one is November 20th, and then the December show will be on December 18th. And it's a really great show with a lot of great women and occasionally some men and musicians and storytellers and comedians and yada, yada, yada.
I want to talk to you about Trump coming back from Asia.
Is he back or is he still in flight? I like to think of him as sort of in purgatory when he's not here. But where is he now?
I don't know, but let's build a wall just to keep him out.
Oh, my God. I actually breathe a little easier when he's out of the country, even though he could be causing all kinds of havoc, wreaking havoc and, you know, putting us all at risk. But it's a little bit better when he's not here. I feel a little less embarrassed.
Was it a failure? Was it a success? Was it a non-event?
David, to be honest, it's hard for me to watch. It is like looking at the sun. I really, it's painful. The optics were bad. And then the fact that he's just rebranding the United States as this oligarchical, strong, maniacal, anti-human rights blob of land. And you want to talk about, remember Sarah Palin's palling around with, what was the next word in that? She accused Obama of palling around with, not terrorists, but...
I think it was terrorists.
Maybe it was terrorists. I mean, this guy is really...
Heirs.
That is what... Heirs, right. She called him a terrorist. This guy is... DT is palling around with dictators and horrible, horrible people. It's just mind-boggling.
Duterte.
Oh my gosh. Who brags about killing people. I mean, I'm telling you honestly, I can't keep it straight. I can't keep the story in Egypt straight. The young guy that's firing everybody and throwing them in, you know, getting rid of, I can't keep that straight, except that apparently we support him, according to Trump. And Jared's over there making deals and stuff. And then this is just a substance storm. I don't know what to say.
Yeah, one of the things we're doing on this show, we did it last week and we're going to do it on every episode, is to review just the headlines so people can keep things straight, because it's almost impossible. And that's how fascism thrives, when people cannot keep all the important stories straight. For example, Amy Schumer is dating a chef.
Yeah, I don't think that's the kind of story that's gonna help fascism.
Well, I mean, that's an important story.
How is it important? Is he a chef for Putin?
I don't know. But wouldn't you like to date a chef? Wouldn't that solve all your problems?
Not right now. I'm trying to lose weight. I don't want to be with somebody who's a really, really good cook. That's not going to help me.
But if it's...
I'd like to date someone who owns a Pilates franchise. That would be nice.
I think it would be fun to date somebody who could cook really healthy food for me.
Well, yeah, if it's really healthy and tasty, that's good. But I think even if I were a vegetarian or a vegan, I could still find a way to eat too much. You know what I mean? But I'm glad if she's happy. I mean, I don't know her, but she deserves, happiness and stuff. And she's a very witty girl.
Mm-hmm. Well,
she's doing a play also. She's doing a Broadway play.
She's doing a play written by Steve Martin.
Oh, that's right.
So these are some of the top stories. Louis C.K.'s former manager, Dave Becky, says he's deeply sorry that he didn't listen to women who accused Louis C.K. of sexual assault.
Certainly sexual harassment. You know, this whole thing has been wild. I mean, Louis C.K., in his own act, sort of made declarations and said things that seemed like he was I don't know, aware. I don't even know how to classify it. I will say this, although there's a very, very low bar around the area of apology or owning what one's done or with these men or taking responsibility for the sexual harassment, abuse, emotional, physical, otherwise. His statement to me was the most complete and thought out one that anyone has released so far. So I can respect that. But the stuff that he described doing, I mean, I'm just gobsmacked.
Yeah.
But I've been around male comedians and they can be hyper sexual, hyper violent, hyper crazy. But that's just, it's what was that song from, It's Hard Out Here for a Pimp? It's hard out here for a girl, you know, for a woman.
Oh, yeah.
Existing, just to exist in this world, to have to, I remember in the 70s, growing up in New York City, being terrified when I had to just walk down 42nd Street with all the marquees and nudie this and this and that, you know, and pictures of women where it was just, I just felt like meat, you know, mm-hmm. like just it, having to walk near that.
What is the stare? Me to I that. Keep hearing about the stare, the male stare. I'm not guilty of anything, but I think in the past I've walked down the streets of New York and I've paid attention to whether or not women notice me, which they don't. And I think I'm guilty
to whether or not women notice you. Okay.
So I'll walk and I go, is this woman checking me out? Is this woman checking me out? And I don't stare. And I have noticed that when I'm walking with somebody who's much more attractive, the women kind of check out men. There is some kind of looking back and forth, but now I'm afraid to even look at a dog.
You can look at a dog.
Okay.
Don't look at his ass. I don't know. it's a funny thing about the whole staring thing, because I've worn glasses for a lot of my life, and then at a certain point I got contacts, and I got the sleep-in contacts, and then I finally had laser surgery about 17 years ago. And the morning after the surgery, you know, I had all these drops and stuff that I had to put into my eyes, and I, like, wiped the crust out of my eyes that morning, and I was looking at the hardwood floor in my apartment, and I felt like Superwoman, because it was like everything was so vivid. And I walked out, and I lived in Hell's Kitchen at the time, and I walked out that next morning, and I was kind of wide-eyed looking at people in not the normal head down, keep moving way that I had been brought up to walk in New York City. But I was looking at people, and one thing that I noticed that was kind of nice was there were a lot of very nice looks back and forth, not aggressive, not overly sexual. The people sometimes just looked pleasant.
Right.
And if you looked, sometimes they would say hi, or they would, you know, and I kind of dug that. Now, I was way older than when I was growing up in the mean, you know, streets of New York in the 70s, and it was crazy. And it was like catcalls and construction workers and guys saying shit like sit on my face and whatnot, which was just not nice. So I it wasn't as much the stare for me as it was the kind of things people said that was just so ridiculous. You're walking down the street. Do you really think telling somebody, you know, you've got a big ass is going to make them go, holy shit, you're what I've been looking for. I've been waiting for someone to say that to me. Come be with me, homeless guy or bicycle messenger or whoever. I mean, this is weird. It's very weird.
And
that people say,
is it fair to say, and you're not a historian, but is it fair to say that, and I apologize for asking this question, up until now, this is something women just had to get acclimatized to?
Unfortunately, you kind of, you know, it's the world is, it's not fair. You know, there are certain things. This is the cornerstone of my therapy for the last X number of years, things not being fair. I can almost laugh about it now because, as my sweet late father said to me, kiddo, whoever said life was fair, you know, it's not. But yeah.
But he never met a millennial.
Well, yeah, right. But yeah, it has been not easy to live in a man's world, to live in a white, predominantly white man's world where rules just, you know, different rules apply and deals are made on the golf course and discussions are almost spoken in tongues in a way that, that women can't, you know, aren't a part of. And guys, and one of the sad things about this whole sexual harassment, all the blow up of big prominent people who are now coming to terms with what they've done, the men have done, is it's all well and good for what's going on in Hollywood and for these high level bigwigs. But what about like regular working women who are just doing what, just trying to make it in a working class job with a nameless boss who's not Bill O'Reilly? I mean, how are they met? How are they? Will things change for them? I hope so, because the numbers there are 2 bajillion times as many as the actresses or people at Fox News or people in Dustin Hoffman plays, you know, or whoever. I mean, it's like every, you know, I mean, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's good that it's coming out, but there's a lot more women that have had to suffer through this. And if one more person says some crap like, yeah, well, so why didn't they say anything? Why didn't they say anything? That's,
I'm afraid to criticize Dave Becky, Louis C.K.'s manager.
And you're afraid because it might reverberate.
Right. I'm afraid to say.
I know.
I'm afraid to say.
I
your,
know
your apology is unacceptable.
I know.
You're his manager. You're collecting 15%.
Yeah,
your job
maybe more.
Is to,
wait a minute.
Yeah, and your job
he's
is
the
to,
head of three arts.
The yeah,
arts
your
is
job
the production
is to,
arm of all these shows. I know I've tried to connect with three arts as a person that considers herself witty and once, you know, wanted to get pitch shows and whatnot. These are powerful people that can control a certain group of people's careers. But I mean, I know. And that's on our level. So what about if it's somebody, if it's a teacher and it's a principal, or if it's a manager and you're, you know, or the owner of a restaurant and you're a waitress and no one knows their name? How are they managing?
Well, you know how I've noticed Hollywood works. Not for everybody, but for a lot. You end up getting great representation if you've got a dirty, dark secret. Because if you have a dirty, dark secret, you create jobs for people like Dave Becky, who runs Three Arts, to clean up after you. If you show up to work, do your job, you don't harass people, you don't whip it out, you're a professional, then you have no need for handlers. If you're easy to work with and you don't create tension on the set, you're not creating jobs. I've been the beneficiary.
Hold on. Oh, I finally followed you when you said it. That sec. You mean offensive people with deep dark secrets or whatnot are they're the job creators? Is what
they
are
job creators. They would never. So, a person who's clean is gonna question his management when they don't do anything for them because most managers don't do anything for you. But if you clean up a mess for me, then I'm indebted to you for the rest of my life. That's, and at least in show business, a lot of these managers are collecting extraordinary amounts of money because they have the dirt on their clients.
Oh, gosh, I never really put that together, but that is a very, very...
Well, Brad Gray from Brillstein Gray used Anthony Pelicano, the private detective,
to snoop on his clients.
Yep.
Oh my gosh, that's absolutely right.
Remember that story?
That's absolutely right. Wait, but also
Chris
he was
Rock
also ripping
Chris,
off. He was also ripping off Gary Shandling, though, right?
In the trial, Chris Rock had his phone tapped by Anthony Pelicano,
and Chris Rock was a client of Brad Gray's.
I don't think he was a client of Brad Gray's, but they want dirt on you. Let me look.
Well, that's what they say is happening right now with some of the women that have accused Roy. I read that Breitbart is already, well, the Breitbart News has already sent some people, dispatched some people down to Alabama to quote unquote get dirt on. I mean, are they going to get dirt on the 14-year-olds when it happened or post 14, 15, 16-year-old dirt? Because the thing about the kind of violation that happened to these children is it taints the waters. It poisons your whole life.
Yeah.
It just does. So, I mean...
Dennis Wasser represented Tom Cruise in his divorce against Nicole Kidman. Cruise's attorney hired Pellicano and tapes of conversations that Nicole Kidman had were released right before the divorce. So that's what, you know, they, anyway.
So wait, this whole job creation thing, this is like, this may be the key to why, where Trump is going to create these jobs. I mean, he's hired criminals and incompetents to head huge agencies where there are on the innocent end, conflict of interest, and on the devious end, they're profiting from, you know, these positions. And that's going to create like jobs for lawyers and PR firms and handlers. And
that's why if you're a deviant, you're going to thrive in show business, because the parasites say, oh, good, he's abusive, he needs me.
That's really, 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 really grotesque. But I think you're onto something. I really do. Oh, how horrible. How horrible.
George Herbert Walker Bush. He's accused of groping a 16-year-old girl.
Now, is this as a president, or is this since he's been in the wheelchair?
He's assaulted six women. Rosalind Corrigan, the daughter of a CIA employee,
do we know when this happened?
2003. This is now the sixth woman who's been grabbed by George Herbert Walker Bush.
Jeez. Gee whiz.
I hope that's how he's remembered.
And he's denied them. He apologized to somebody.
Yeah.
Where does this stand?
Well, he's apologized. You know, that's what he did. Like the Bush family, you know, we cry a lot. You ever hear them say that? We cry a lot. We're very emotional.
Oh, I think I have, yeah.
Yeah, we grope.
Golly Moses. Well, God knows that there's been craziness going on in the House and the Senate and in politics for the longest kind of time. Look, by the way, I'm certainly not going to let this conversation pass and give Bill Clinton a pass, because he was as dastardly as everybody else. Now, the difference being, he was impeached. Mm-hmm. There was, you know, yes, it was for lying and not necessarily for his actions, but he did suffer some consequences. Where I get really PO'd, David, and this is really what needs to change, but I don't know how it would happen, is I want these guys to not only have to pay money to the women that they've hurt, and a lot of money, but not get away with not having to admit guilt. I want them saying that they did something and paying the money. They need to do both, because that way to slither away from, you know, no guilt was admitted, and, you know, they admitted no guilt, and, you know, it's a settlement and with a gag order, and you can't talk. No, that's a huge part of the problem.
But then you got to bring the lawyers in.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, it's not right. It's just not. And what it does is it creates an environment of your silence is worth a certain amount of money. If you talk, you're worthless. But if you stay silent, then we'll give you money. And it taints the waters completely for everyone, because there's many, many, many reasons that people stay silent. And it's not because they're getting paid. It's because of the shame and the hurt and the, I can't even believe this happened. I'd rather never think about it again. Blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a mess. It's a mess. And that Trump himself has managed to dance away from the charges. What happened to those women?
Yeah.
He was going to sue all of them. Did all those cases go away? What happened to them? Are they alive? Did somebody like get rid of them? What's going on?
I think one of them is still alive. I'm not sure.
I mean, I'm not trying to be funny. It's just that even with this as a huge news story, there is sometimes a mention of Trump and the tape and him mentioning the grabbing, you know, actions. But there's...
And who said my man?
Yeah, right.
George Herbert Walker Bush's nephew?
That's right. Oh, my God. Billy Bush. Who suffered worse consequences than Donald Trump, I might add.
Billy Bush. You know?
Yeah. I mean, he got, you know, actually, I have to correct myself. He did not suffer worse consequences. He had a high-paying job. He lost the high-paying job, but I think he was still paid somewhat of a settlement, even though he was caught on tape going into agreement with pretty egregious behavior, which makes me wonder, who's writing these contracts? I guess I need to get me a lawyer like that where I can, you know, get a big payoff. That's the other problem. Roger L's payoff after what he did. Bill O'Reilly, huge payoff, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know what's happening with Weinstein or but these guys aren't, they don't suffer. They're, you know.
Well, I think Weinstein's going to suffer. Just thinking about divorce attorneys. It's going to be a feeding frenzy.
That'll be a feeding frenzy. And then there's Brett Ratner and God, who else? I can't keep it straight.
We're running out of time.
Okay.
But
we have to end on something that's positive.
Well, I'm positive that Brett Ratner is guilty.
Okay. that's not the kind of positive that I was.
Here's something positive. How quickly things happen. Revolutions bubble underneath the surface, and then they explode, and overnight things change. For example, Harvey Weinstein seems ancient history. That first.
Oh my God! You better believe it. I mean, yeah.
October 6th. Let me read you something. You can respond, and then
okay.
Caitlin Flanagan has a new piece in The Atlantic. This is her opening paragraph. The most remarkable thing about the current tide of sexual assault and harassment accusations is not their number. If every woman in America started talking about the things that happen during the course of an ordinary female life, it would never end. Nor is it the power of the men involved. History instructs us that for countless men, the ability to possess women sexually is not a spoil of power, it's the point of power. This is what she ends the paragraph with, and I want you to respond to.
Oh, my goodness.
What's remarkable is that these women are being believed. That's the inflection point. Since Harvey Weinstein...
Mm-hmm.
What has changed is nobody's questioning the veracity of these accusations.
Well, they still are, but I think they're being questioned less. And I think the why didn't they come out sooner is sounding more and more ridiculous. And the if these accusations are true, then blah, 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 blah. When you've got people corroborating it, people saying that they were, and that is a very, very, very important part of this, is a big reason. Well, look, I can't speak for a group of people, but I would say a big reason that many people don't talk about these things is because they don't think that they'll be believed. And because with the men that perpetrate the crimes, they have a certain amount of power, and they either threaten them or they're afraid that they could be hurt financially, physically, professionally, blah, blah, blah. I mean, you know, there is a fear, but believing women has not been something this country has done regularly.
Yeah.
And maybe a big part of what's going on now, and maybe this is an inadvertent gift of the current president, is the level of how appalling it is to have someone like that at the top that actually still got in. And maybe this situation with Roy Moore, another politician, similar things, maybe people are now going, wait, that it shouldn't have happened before. We shouldn't let someone like that in again. These are people that can influence women and men's lives. They can make judicial appointments and signing statements that are going to really affect people. These are people, you know, I'm thinking in a lot of different ways. And that's already, I think my sentence was one of the longer ones in history. Yeah, women haven't been listened to in a lot of ways. Women are beginning to be listened to, and as God is my judge, may that continue and only get more and more deep and more resonant as time goes on, because it sure has been a shitty way to live.
Tom Sizemore was taken off a film set about 13, 14 years ago because he was caught molesting an 11-year-old girl.
Oh, my. Oh, my.
And the rumors spread. Nobody pressed charges. And then he ends up on the set of the movie Piggy Banks. Why? The same way I said that if you're a deviant, it's easier for you to find managers and agents because you create work and button men and buffers to clean up after you. All the parasites in Hollywood gravitate to you because they have
you
to,
need them.
You need them. And then you get your dirty, dark secret on him, and then he pays you without question. You don't have to work. Tom Sizemore
got
hot.
I heard that. I heard his issue was more was drugs and sleaze and stuff, but I did not know about that. He was he ever charged? Did were charges pressed?
Well, he was arrested for domestic violence.
Oh, that I remember. Yeah,
and as was Christian Slater, who works again.
Right.
And
right. Well, what's his name? Charlie Sheen. Yeah, Charlie Sheen, well, I don't know. Well, yeah, his life has been all over the map, and it didn't stop him for years and years and years and years and years. He was still making a lot of money doing Two and a Half Men.
Yeah.
And then another series after that, after being fired off of Two and a Half Men.
They hire Tom Sizemore because the directors, the producers, are turned on by the behavior. They think it's interesting. They want to capture it on tape, on film. Plus, if he's abusive towards them, they can dismiss it as, well, he's a criminal. Doesn't hurt that much when a known sociopath is abusing you. That's why these people find work. They're the devil you know. People rather work with the devil they know than somebody who might abuse you because you are incompetent and they're just politely pointing it out.
Oh, dear.
I'd rather have somebody abuse me because they're abusive and they're a sadist than somebody politely and methodically correcting my work and pointing out my inadequacies.
Well, that's just ducky, and that's cowardice, and that's...
That's how Hollywood works. People in Hollywood are afraid of getting found out. That's their biggest fear. Everybody comes to Hollywood because they're half a creative person. They can't do it by themselves. So they go to Hollywood and join the team. And that's great.
Well, look, and the thing is, let's also be clear about this. As much as people have talked about a casting couch in Hollywood and all of that for years and years and years, and people are pointing their fingers at Hollywood, as they should, because there's been mischief forever.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just Hollywood. It's everywhere.
Right.
And
that's why bullies succeed. You're told to consider the source. Consider the source. When somebody when somebody makes you feel bad, and they will, especially in the workplace, you're told to consider the source.
Yeah.
So in Hollywood, most people are incompetent. Most people in Hollywood are just been raised on a diet of movies and television and fan magazines, and they know absolutely nothing, and they just want to be around it, and they have no talent, and they don't want to be found out. Now, if they're around somebody who's a professional, who's competent, who works 8-hour days and then goes home and sees his family or her family and is efficient and isn't abusive, when they point out the mistakes you're making, it hurts because...
In a different way than someone that you could just write off.
Exactly. So people, most people in Hollywood, because they're craven and lacking and half a human being, they will gravitate to monsters because when the monster turns on them, they consider the source and they go, well, it's a monster. It doesn't mean anything, as opposed to somebody like Conan O'Brien. You know, if Conan O'Brien corrects your work, it hurts because Conan is brilliant. So most people would rather work for a monster because they can write that person off.
I don't know if I can go along with that. I mean, now I haven't lived in Hollywood in 22 years, and I was only there for about seven, and that was late 80s to mid 90s. And I had the privilege of working with some really talented, really not crazy people, just real solid, hardworking, ethical people. Having said that, I was also in an acting class that was like kind of a front for blankingtology. I don't want to get into that because I don't want your, mm-hmm. you know, your show to get sued. But that was just a crazy, crazy setup. And the thing I will say about Hollywood and casting and the vagueness of it all is there is this, you know, you pick people you want to work with. You pick people who, you know, seem pleasant, are attractive, are this or that. They're all of these unspecific qualities that are, you know, it's just a weird thing where it's not necessarily, things aren't based on merit. It's a lot more, I don't know, I want to say esoteric, but that's not even it. Anyway, this other quotient can just make for just a mess. And I think it's that way in just about every profession where men and women are working, and sometimes even women and women and men and men, because the aggressors aren't, you know, they're not heterosexually gender specific. You know, I mean, there's craziness that's going on, you know, ad nauseum, I'd say.
And as the country gets dumber and dumber, which we are, and the schools are failing us, which they are.
David, this is just really bringing me down. I'm going to have to get some, like, I don't know, Alka-Seltzer Plus or something after we get off the phone. It's bad, but there's got to be, you know, maybe this is the beginning of, maybe we're at the low, low, low point they talk about in AA. You have to go low, low, low. You go lower, you go lower, you go lower. And then, you know, you can start seeing.
One of John McCain's favorite saying, I think it's like, it's always darkest before you die.
Is that what he...
That's one of the few funny things that John McCain has said.
So, well, I've been mad at him for some stuff, but I still remember McCain-Feingold, which I thought was a really noble bill. And he's been one of the few people that's willing to, you know, say what's right. I don't know what's going on with this party that people could say, even if he was a pedophile, I'd rather have Roy Moore than the Democrat. Okay. What? What are you?
The Giles files.
The Giles files. Yes. We've got a really cool episode where we talk to a wonderful filmmaker who has a new movie called Black Cop. And then we talk to a real Weehawken police officer and get his perspective. And the variety show is called The Mosquito in New York City, November 20th and December 18th, 7:30 at night, Monday nights, and look at Dixon Place.
And look for Nancy on MSNBC.
And on CBS News Sunday mornings. And, of course, listen to David Feldman as often and as, you know.
If you need a reason to slit your throat.
Oh, no, I would never say that.
I will. Stay on the line for 1 second, okay?
Okay.